Good morning. Welcome to Scarva Street on Sunday, the 6th of March. We bring our worship to God. We think of the Shepherd Psalm today, Psalm 23. Friends, just one or two announcements this morning. If you're joining us for the first time online or you're returning, it's lovely as ever to have your company on the Lord's Day. Just to let you know that services will continue online week by week. This evening there is a Council for Mission in Ireland rally in Third Raphair Island at 7 o'clock, and we're glad to have Dr. Bruce, who will be speaking at that meeting. Dr. Bruce is touring our presbytery. He's just about finishing his tour today, and we thank him and his wife Zoe for coming and for giving of themselves so fully throughout this past week. Our midweek meeting is on Wednesday at 8 o'clock in the Irvine Hall. We continue our thinking on living in the light of the resurrection. And next Sunday we move into Mark chapter 7, and we think of the nature of man and the grace of God. Let's come and bring our worship to God. We sing our opening praise, "How great thou art."
Thou art.
we come to God in prayer. Father, we bless you for how you have revealed your many attributes and those of your Son and the Holy Spirit throughout the Scriptures. We bless you, O God, that you come as one who is almighty, all able to do exactly what he purposes, and yet you also come as the Father who dearly loves his children. And though so often disappointed with us, yet your love never decreases. And your joy in what we will one day be is never diminished. And so, O Lord, we come gladly, coming in the precious name of Jesus Christ. And we pray that you will bless us as we enter into worship today. O God, we thank you that we think of the Shepherd's Psalm today, that picture in the Old Testament of what you would choose to do in the person of your Son when he would come to earth, the Good Shepherd, the one who would watch over his sheep, the one who would feed, the one who would keep, the one who would provide and delight in the sheep and one day bring them to their heavenly home. Lord, in the midst of a world in turmoil at present, we thank you that he who is almighty is filled with love and compassion, whose strength is unquestioned and his tenderness unrivaled. And so, O Lord, we are glad to affirm our faith in Jesus Christ and pledge anew our love to you, our God in heaven. Forgive our sins, O Lord, and lead us ever in your way. And during our time in your word, in these familiar verses, come by your Spirit, deepen our understanding, but Lord, more than that, set our hearts on fire anew with love and devotion to you. Lord, hear our prayer. For Jesus' sake. Amen. We read together the Shepherd's Psalm, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. We thank God for his truth. Boys and girls, we know that Jesus is the Good Shepherd, and he looks after us as if we were his precious sheep. And the most familiar passage in the Old Testament is probably the 23rd Psalm, which begins, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And we have a little cartoon presentation of that psalm. So I hope you'll be able to remember it as you see the different pictures coming onto the screen. It begins with the Lord being the shepherd of his sheep, the one who will look after the sheep, teaching us that Jesus looks after us, and so we are to trust him. And the picture of the sheep following him is that we're to listen to the words of Jesus in the Gospels, listening to the whole of God's Bible, for it's all given from heaven to us that we might know all we need to know about living for God. The Psalm 23 speaks of lying down in green pastures. Now the green pastures are where the sheep feeds, so God is going to provide for all our needs. That's his promise. Lead us by still waters. The sheep need something cool to drink. And food and water reminds us that God provides for all our needs. And even though things are changing, the seasons change, God will lead us. Jesus will lead us. Every day he will make us new in heart, and he'll help us to grow. As the seasons change, so we grow to be more and more the boy or girl he wants us to be. The psalm speaks about leading us in paths of righteousness, and Jesus is the one who directs how we should live, and we find that when we learn from our Bibles. And we can learn from older Christians too, who've walked paths of righteousness before us. And then, of course, life can be very hard. And in the psalm, we read of leading us through the valley of the shadow of death. So even the most difficult times, the most sad times, we know that Jesus is right there with us. And that's something that the Christian boy or girl has very important in their hearts, because no matter how troubled the time is, we know that Jesus is always there with us. And no matter what happens, he will keep us safe. No matter what happens in life, we'll always belong to him, and nothing will be able to take us out of his love and care. The psalm speaks towards the end about having a table set before us, the idea that we can eat all the wonderful things that God has provided for us. It's not a table and it's not eating food, but it's reminding us that no matter what happens, God will always be giving us of the very best. He knows what we need. We don't always know that, but God knows what we need, and he will always provide it for us fully. And then he anoints our head with oil. That's in the psalm. That just lets us know that we're very special to him. And each one is very special to him. And the psalm ends with saying that we will know his mercy and his love all the days of our lives, that we will always know and experience God's love as we just simply remember him and yield our hearts to him. And then the last little picture, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That speaks of heaven. And one day Jesus will take all his boys and girls to be with him in heaven. It's a wonderful psalm, and it reminds us of God's love from beginning to end. And so when we trust him in our hearts, we can remember that all these promises are ours. Let's have a little prayer. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for Jesus' great love for us. We thank you that he is the good shepherd. We thank you that he promises to provide all we need. We thank that even in difficult times, he is there, right beside us, and he will not let any eternal harm come to us. And all we truly need, he will give. And he will give what's best, and the best of what's best. And we thank you, O Lord, that we will always have his love, and one day, by his grace, we will be with him in heaven. Lord, hear our prayer as boys and girls, as we thank you for Jesus, who is our good shepherd. Amen. Boys and girls, we'll have another story for you next week. See you then. Friends, as we come to pray for others today, our focus is very much and has been the country of Ukraine and its people, the bravery of its prime minister and leaders, and a military which is facing an onslaught of unthinkable proportion. This service is recorded on Tuesday, the 1st of March, and as you receive it on Sunday, the 6th, we're not sure just what may happen in the ensuing days. But we come to God in prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, we ask your blessing upon your world in all its multiplicity of need. And Lord, while our thoughts are so drawn to Ukraine today, we know that there are many parts of your world which might have been in the forefront of our minds but have been pushed to the back. We think of Afghanistan, or Syria, or the Sudan. We think of places where there have been earthquakes and volcanoes, tsunamis. We ask, O God, that where there is need, that people will not be forgotten, and that in your mercy you will multiply the aid given, just as Jesus long ago multiplied the bread and the fish, that you will allow what is needed to get to those who need it most. But Lord, our hearts are heavy for the people of Ukraine today. We ask, O God, your hand in grace upon those who are stepping forward with such bravery and conviction, and those who just want to live in peace, to be the nation they are, a sovereign nation able to determine their own future. Lord, we prize our democratic freedoms, and we pray that Ukraine will not lose her democratic freedoms. We pray for the thwarting of the aggressor. We pray for justice because of crimes against humanity that have been committed. But Lord, we know that we are not in control of these things, and no power or authority on earth is. We cry out for peace and justice in our own day, but we acknowledge, O God, that you will bring peace in your time, and you will exercise justice in your time. And that reminds us to be humble before you, and to wait in faith upon you. We pray for those who suffer today, those who have lost loved ones, those who have been maimed, those who have been mentally scarred from which they will never fully recover. We pray for those in danger today. We ask, O God, that in your mercy you will draw near by your Spirit and overshadow all those who need that touch of grace upon mind and heart and life. And you who know the end from the beginning, may your glory not only appear, but be seen, a glory that comes from God. Lord, bless our own church family, those who need your touch today. Grant them grace and peace where they are. And Lord, be your teacher as we gather around your word, and let us know its truth. For Jesus' sake. Amen. Cain will lead us in that lovely hymn, Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that brought me here below, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains have gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has rescued me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. Lord has promised good to me. His word my hope ensures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains have gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. Like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. Shall soon dissolve like snow, sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. He'll be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Friends, we come to perhaps the most familiar passage in the Old Testament, the Shepherd's Psalm, Psalm 23. And in the middle of God's Bible, there is the Book of Psalms, the song book. And when we think of the religions around the world, this is the only tradition that calls people to sing. God, who made the mind and the mouth, desires a concerted and thoughtful praise to his name. The song speaks in anticipation of what the believer's experience is and will be. And the passages in the Old Testament that speak of the Lord being the shepherd of his sheep, the faithful shepherd, is perhaps best known represented here in this psalm. And friends, as we look at this psalm, I simply want to go down through its verses and have a simple study. Because these words are so familiar, and because they're poetic in form, we sometimes just don't see the import that God has for us. We rejoice in the imagery, but we maybe don't think that deeply about it. The psalm begins by a statement of faith, and then the resultant verses speak of the blessings that come to the believer because of that faith. And because we know that faith comes as a gift of God, then there's no room for us to boast. We simply rejoice in the faith we have in Jesus Christ, that gift of God that we're glad to exercise, and all the benefits that flow from that, we want to give glory back to God for each. So we read, "The Lord is my shepherd." Words that are so familiar, but very particular words. Not "the Lord is a shepherd," or "the Lord is one of many shepherds," or even "the Lord is the shepherd, the only one." It's "the Lord is my shepherd." It's a statement of faith. And so the shepherd psalm doesn't give automatic comfort to the reader, but it does give complete comfort to the reader who has come to God in faith. And we know today, in the fullness of the revelation, that faith is founded alone on Jesus Christ, the eternal Son, who is the Good Shepherd. So can we echo those words with David even today? "The Lord is my shepherd. This is my faith. The Lord, the eternal one, the one who's revealed himself in the Scriptures, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the Son coming to live for me and die for me, he who is the Good Shepherd, he is my shepherd. My trust is in him. My all is founded in what he has promised and what he will accomplish. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall lack nothing." Doesn't mean that we will never have a sense of loss, but we will lack nothing that God knows we need, and nothing that he purposes to enable us to do his will. There are many things in life that are temporary. In fact, nearly everything. The only thing that we take with us is our faith in Jesus. But we will lack nothing that God knows we need and purposes to give us. And then the psalmist takes us on this just pastoral picture. "He makes me lie down in green pastures." I know the sheep farmers in our community will know that the sheep will only lie down when they feel safe and secure. And I'm sure we've all seen instances maybe where a farm gate is opened and the sheep hear it and they jump up to their feet. They're on alert with the noise. To lie down in green pastures, the sheep feels completely safe and secure. The green pastures, that which nourishes the sheep. God is speaking of the word that he gives to his people. We are his sheep. Under his care, he feeds us. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Jesus teaches us in Matthew 4. God feeds his sheep, and he feeds us through his inerrant word, a word that we can handle, a word that we can trust completely. God says, so we believe. God commands, so we seek to do. To lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. We often hear the phrase, still waters run deep. And I remember being up in the Mourne, the Shimna River, and just looking into the little pools and how crystal clear the water was. And in those little pond parts of the river where there's it's almost like glass and you can see right down to the bottom. That's the picture there. In the scriptures, the sea in its raging, which of course you can't see through because of the froth and the movement. What's underneath is hidden. It's a picture of being confused. But with the still waters, transparent, nothing is hidden. Nothing is confusing. Everything is clear. Everything is true. That's the picture. It's the Holy Spirit who, when we take of the green pastures, he makes the truth plain. And we can rejoice in the word that God gives. He restores my soul. When Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden and cast out from that garden, they had sinned and they were spiritually cut off from God, and then the soul began to disintegrate and then the body died. But here we have the restoring of the soul. The real person inside, and we come to faith in Christ, then God begins that work within us that restores what he wants us to be, what he purposes for us, to realign our thinking and to help us to understand our emotions, the things that move us. And deep down in the soul to not only look for and rejoice in good things, but have that sense of peace and well-being. He restores my soul. The psalmist goes on, he guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. That we are to have a new way of living as Christians. And that is for his name's sake. And isn't that the greatest spur to living for Jesus? Because it's to his honor. It's not just that it's the right thing to do, not the right words to say, or the right ambitions to adopt. It's for his name's sake that every word, every thought, every reaching out, every action can be done for his name's sake. For the Lord who's my shepherd, the Lord who feeds me and helps me understand that I might walk in righteous paths to bring him honor. Then the psalm takes a darker tone. God's word doesn't just speak to us about what is bright and joyful or happy or easy. It also speaks of the difficult and the dark times. And aren't we glad God does that? So that we are to understand that he is sovereign over these times too. And that by faith he will bring us through them. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. It's a picture, isn't it? It's a walk. When we think of death, don't we think of fear and worry? We don't think of a calm walk. But here the psalmist says, even though I walk, not in a valley, but through a valley. And when we walk through a valley, we are walking to a destination beyond that valley. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, a shadow cannot harm us. And that's how God here pictures death for the believer. It cannot harm us. Because these bodies need to be transformed by the power of the Spirit that we may dwell in body forever in heaven with God. So our bodies are decaying but will be transformed. Earthly death is only a shadow in the light and glory of eternity. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. When it comes our time to take that walk, the shepherd says, I'll be there. I'll be beside you. And the shepherd, as we know, has been through that valley himself. And he went through it alone because his father needed to turn from him when he was on the cross. But the shepherd tells us, I'll be with you. You'll not be alone. Then the psalmist speaks of the shepherd's implements, the rod and the staff. Probably just the one implement, a rod, and the other end, the staff with the little shepherd's hook on it. A rod to prod, to get the sheep to go in the right direction. A little dig in the ribs, perhaps. But the crook, if the sheep would fall down some type of ravine to reach down and gather the sheep round the middle and pull it up. A rod to correct. A staff to lift. The shepherd's care, a picture not only of those two things, but how whatever we need, whether we need to be corrected or helped, the shepherd is there. When I was a boy, I was really confused about verse 5. And I had the picture of, it's actually, I think, a cowboy Indian picture. Maybe gives my age away. And the wagon's in a circle. And the Indians riding and their horses making the noise and shooting arrows, and the cavalry inside this ring of wagons with a Christmas dinner, sitting, eating, with the arrows firing round about them. I don't know how you've pictured this. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. But whatever our enemies in life, whether it's rejection, disappointment, whether it's pain, whether it's anxiety, whether it's a sense of failure, whatever the enemies that come to us day by day, there's the picture of God providing richly for our needs, whatever they may be, and the sense that we can be calm in the presence of enemies, knowing that the Lord sees it all and he watches over his people. You anoint my head with oil. Kings were anointed. An important person was anointed in Bible days. Here God says, every one of my sheep is precious, exalted, anointed before me, individually. You anoint my head with oil. You declare me to be precious because of the price that is on my head, even the blood of Jesus. My cup overflows. God pouring out his blessings upon us day by day. Not that the cup is full, but the cup is overflowing. It is more than full. More than I truly need, God pours out into my cup. He is not short in giving blessing to his children. But sometimes we just don't see it. Isn't that right? How has God blessed you in the week that has passed? Have you taken time to rejoice and time to give thanks? Because the Lord is your shepherd. Your cup will overflow. And the last verse, surely it's not a question, it's a statement. It's truly. Truly, this is sure, this is a certain thing. Goodness and love. God's grace extended to me will follow me, not might or sometimes. It will follow me all the days of my life. Not one date in the calendar of your life that the Lord's hand is not there. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord. I will be with him in the place that is truly home, and not for a time, forever. Can we echo these things in our hearts? The Lord is my shepherd. I shall lack nothing. And then, one day, I will dwell in his house forever. This is our faith. This is our hope. This is our joy. May God bless these words to our hearts. Let us pray. Father, we bless you for your word in all its fullness, a word that we just begin to explore. We ask, O Lord, that you'll bless this familiar psalm, allow us to think upon its sections more deeply, to rejoice in you more fully, and to know more and more of the joy of the shepherd who saves and keeps and will one day delight in each child, each sheep, as they one day will be. Hear our prayer for Jesus' sake. Amen. In thinking about the Lord being our shepherd today, in our final praise, we rejoice, the Lord is my salvation.
The grace of God has reached for me and pulled me from the raging sea, and I am safe on this solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. Your strength will help me scale these walls. I'll see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful in love? My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. My hope is hidden in the Lord. He fulfills each promise of his word. When winter fades, I know spring will come. The Lord is my salvation. In times of waiting, times of need, when I know loss, when I am weak, I know his grace will renew these days. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful in love? My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. And when I reach my final day, he will not leave me in the grave, but I will rise. He will call me home. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful in love? My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation.
God, the Spirit.
we draw near to God in prayer. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all this day and evermore. Amen.